Hey everybody, can you hear me? Awesome. So my name is Chris Noring. I thought I'd come here from Sweden, or technically I live in London nowadays, but I'm here to talk about TypeScript fundamentals. So a first question to you guys, how many are using TypeScript today? Is that with Angular 2? And Angular 1? And the rest of you is like TypeScript and something else? All right, cool. So the first time I encountered TypeScript, it was kind of the only difference in the beginning when I looked at TypeScript was thinking, well, this is just ES6 with interfaces, right? And then I started to actually deep dig into TypeScript and realized it was, you know, a big kind of superset of JavaScript that was very competent, a lot of really cool functions. Yeah, that's just me by the way. So Google developer expert, if you want to tweet me, it's Chris_Noring. But TypeScript. So the reason for it being called TypeScript is because it has types. So there are basically the reason for using types is that it adds clarity to your code. And also it gives you compile time errors instead of, you know, runtime errors. And this is really the big benefit of using TypeScript at all. So for example here, you can see that on the number 2 here on the right, TypeScript will ensure that you don't mess this up. Because if you use, as you see in the example, the add method with the 1 and test, we are kind of mixing types, right? We get the result, but it's not what we expect. But in the other case, when we use 2 numbers, we get what we want. So you see here, TypeScript can actually fix that scenario for us. The 1 test can actually become what we want it to be, right? And this is really the point with TypeScript, is by being more clear about your intentions. So let's first have a look at the different types in TypeScript. These are Boolean, number, string, and any. And any is the base type that everyone inherits from, as the bottom left graph is showing. If you look at to the right here, you can see that we are assigning a value to A, and TypeScript is taking the opportunity of guessing the type for us. So in this case, it's guesses. Well, this looks like a number, so I decide that you on initialization, you are a number. On the second row, we see that we're trying to assign it something that's obviously not a number, which actually gives us compile time errors. And if you see the other case here with var string, you see that it becomes a string by TypeScript's guess. And we try to assign it a false, which is a Boolean, and obviously it fails in compile time. And the middle example works out fine because we are more explicit about what type we expect, which is number. And on the second row there, B equals 7, we can clearly see that, well, 2 numbers, we're fine. And the bottom scenario is a scenario I never want to see from any of you guys, right? Can you promise me that? Because in this case, we're telling it to be any, which basically means that we can reassign it with any kind of type we want. So don't do this, even if you can. All right, types example. As you see here on the top left, we have an add method with 2 parameters, and it's written in ES5 with no numbers. This one will have a problem, as I mentioned before. It might not do what you want it to do. It's a very, very simple example just to illustrate the principle. And you see on the bottom left here, we have a TypeScript fixed version of add where we're using numbers for the parameters, which you can see we have number for parameters, and we also have a return type being number. So we are very explicit about our intentions. So here on the right, you see that when we call add with types, we have 2 numbers, and everything is allowed. But if we, on the bottom right here, actually attempt to use a number and a string together, we will get a compile time error. Right, another very cool construct is let and const. But let's first talk about let and the problem it solves. So if you look here at the top left, we see that we declare var a equals 3. We have a while loop, and we declare another var a. And when we console log it, it will actually print 5, which, you know, is one of the built-in constructs in JavaScript, which basically means that the only time a variable is scoped is within a method, not within a while construct. So we will try to fix that by using let instead. So if you look here at the top right, You see that we have let a equals 7, and inside of the while loop, we have a let a equals 5, and on console logging, we get it to be 7. And the reason for that is that when we TypeScript transpiles this into ES5, we see that in the inner while, it has actually created another set of variable for us. So this one solves the problem of scoping. So use let for every single variable you have in TypeScript. Also, a const is pretty neat. It does what we expect it to do. We have a const, we assign it a value. And on the second line, we see that we try to reassign the value, and you know, we get the compile time error that we expect. So far, nothing that cool, but let is useful, right? We have enums and types. So enums is, you know, a pretty common construct in most languages. This one is no different. We have a set of names, books, movies, other, and so on. We have the values of the enum being a number, which is kind of a limitation for us, right? Because sometimes we might actually want to have a value that's a string, for example. And then we can use this type cars thing, or the type keyword. So in this case, we tell cars that you can only be Ferrari, Volvo, or Porsche. That's the only value that you can be. So in this var example case, we tell it to be of type cars, we assign it the value Ferrari, everyone's happy. But on the last line, we see that we try to assign it the value Saab, and it's incorrect, and the compiler is screaming at us, which is what we want. So this one is probably my favorite kind of cleanup feature in TypeScript. It's template strings. I mean, most of us, we used to concatenate a lot of strings. It's even error prone, right? Let's say we lose a plus sign or we do some kind of error, and of course, the readability is horrible. So what can we do about it? We can use something called template strings. As you see here, we use the backtick, which is basically a multi-line thing for us, but we also use it to interpolate base URL and ID. So you see here, every single concatenation you have out there, just replace it with this, and you have increased readability, and it's less error-prone. How many are using this construct? Is this the first thing that you guys use to clean up your code? Okay, it's only me. Fair enough. This one is pretty cool. REST operator. So here we have a number of arguments that we don't know beforehand how many arguments. So if you see here on the bottom left, we see that we can call this method with 4 arguments, but we can also call it with 2 arguments. So we can see here that the REST operator is having these dot, 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 and then a variable name, and it's of type array. And you see in this case, we have a sum function that just takes all the parameters and sum them up. So there's nothing really magical with this, because if you look on the right side, which is the ES5 transpile version, you see that it's using the ES5 built-in arguments. So, but it's still a pretty cool thing to be using, but you know, that thing is actually there in ES5 for you to use, so. For of is a very interesting construct. It solves the problem of using the for in loop. Because, I mean, normally in ES5, when we use a for in, we kind of like, I'd rather use a for each or a normal for, right? Because the for in kind of loops the keys, not exactly what we want in an array, right? So, I mean, if we loop the keys of an array, we kind of get 0, 1, and 2 instead, right? That's not what we want. So the way to solve this is for us to be using a for of loop. So you see here on the number 1. And this one will actually transpile into this ES5 here, where we use a proper for loop. So the for of loop is kind of a more safer version in this case. Default values. Default values are kind of nice, right? Because we have the ability to, let's say that someone forgets to input the parameters of a function, or this is by design, right? So at the top left here, we have the test method that takes 2 parameters, A and B, and by giving it default values, we ensure that, well, it has some kind of basic behavior. And in ES5, you can see that this becomes like an if clause that, you know, if it's not set, then assign a value to it, and so on. Also, this one on the right is pretty cool, because this is a nice pattern that you could be using that's going to follow you into ES5. So what we can see here is that if config is not set, then it's going to actually throw an error. So it will actually execute the mandatory function when config is missing. How many have seen this pattern? OK, a few hands. It's pretty nice, right? You can steal it, because I stole it from another guy. So the internet is free, right? No, he actually said I could take it, so it's fine. So classes, they're a pretty nice thing. They're not exclusive to TypeScript. They're there in ES5, but just the basics. We have a class thing coming, and we have a constructor with input parameters. And of course, our functions are more like methods. They don't have the function keyword. And if you see here on the right here, the ES5, we can see that we have a self-executing function with a constructor function person and so on. And we can see that the methods ends up on the prototype. All right, this is probably one of my favorite things, because I'm a kind of a lazy developer. I think if you're a developer, if you're not lazy, then you're in the wrong profession, am I right? Yeah, thank you. So in this case, we see that we have a lot of accessor things happening inside of a constructor, right? Private, public. First time I saw that, I was like convinced this must be an error, right? I mean, since when are we writing private inside of our parameters? Okay, we have types, right? But this is very, very neat thing to have, because this one will save us a lot of time. This will create member fields for us. That's nice, right? So if you look to the right, you can see that, yeah, we're actually creating the fields here. So service one, service, and vol, they're all created for us by us only writing the accessor name. So yeah, very, very nice. You're all using those, right? TypeScripters, or no? A few of you, awesome. At least one. Thank you, Yuri. OK, so inheritance. Here we have an inheritance with a class shape and a rectangle that extends shape. Of course, a lot of you maybe have moved away from inheritance, are kind of using collaborators nowadays, right? It's kind of a paradigm shift. But if you want to use the classic inheritance, you can, and it will kind of work the way you expect. I mean, you have the extends keyword, and the first thing that happens in a subclass is a call of a base class constructor. And, you know, protected, private, and so on will work the way that you think they will. And you can see here on the right, a lot of cool things happen when it generates this inheritance thing for us. It declares an extends method, the rectangle's prototype equals shape, it creates an instance from shape, and all first level methods in shape are copied to rectangle. So a lot of things are happening. If we want to deep dive, we can, but we really don't, you know, want to, right? So fat arrows. Don't know why, but I kind of like to say the word fat. Fat arrow. OK, so I mean, they're called arrow functions as well. But there is a problem that they are solving, of course. If you look at the top left here, we see that we have this a equals 3, and we have a timeout function and another function within a function. And suddenly, we lose track of this, right? This is a very common thing in JavaScript. Var me equals this. We have written that more than once, right? Or var that equals this. So arrow functions are there for us to solve this problem. So if we look at the middle solution here, we see that we are replacing the setTimeout inner function here with an arrow function. Well, equals larger than makes out an arrow. And we see that we can actually assign to our this, and it will assign to the correct this. And why is that? Well, if we look to the right here at the ES5, we see that the it actually creates our var me equals this, but it calls it underscore this. And that is the way it kind of keeps track of things. But a word of warning, if you have too many callback nestlings, then it might not work anyway. But first level, always use this one. Interfaces. Right, so interfaces is one of those things that you can either think of as optional, or if you're a very organized kind of person, you like interfaces because they kind of tell you about the intention, right? So if you're using something called a revealing module pattern, you kind of declare everything at the top. So, I mean, interfaces continues with the same kind of mantra, right? Because at the top, you're telling this whole service that might be several hundred lines long what it does. But I mean, if you just quickly want to browse the file, you're probably going to look at the interface and not the implementing class, right? So in this case, we have an iService. And what's very specific about TypeScript is that it's not only declaring behavior, which is, you know, the methods. It also declares a field, repo. So we can be very specific about how the implementation of the thing should work. So here we can see that we are forced to declare the repo field, but also the do stuff method. And we can see here when we transpile it that interfaces turns into nothing because they don't exist in ES5. And we can see that our var test becomes this self-executing function as is prudent and normal with a class. But of course, interfaces are magical, right? A little bit. I mean, if you look at what we can do here with the middle row saying var instance, we can actually create an instance from an interface. That means we have a mocking framework, right? But there is a problem, of course, with this, because if we don't use an implementing class to implement an object, then we might forget to set a certain number of fields. So when we create the instance variable, we see that we are responsible for assigning stuff to do stuff and repo and so on, right? So this way of doing stuff might be a bit risky. So I mean, we need to make sure we set all the properties and methods that should be set. That's really the bottom line, right? Because if we're given this power, we should use it with caution. But they're awesome when you do testing, for example, right? Because then you can just define your interface and you can wait a really long time before actually creating the implementing class. Are you with me? Awesome. Just see if you're awake after lunch. Try to wake up myself too. Yeah. Okay, destructuring. More lazy stuff. I love it, right? So destructuring is about saying that I don't want to write the fully qualified name of stuff. I don't want it. So with this destructuring, we are saying that, yeah, we have this rectangle that has a lot of properties like x, y, width, height, and so on, right? But we don't want to write rect x or rect y or, you know, whatever depth we have, right? So the only thing we want to write is x. And by saying like var, you know, curly braces x, y, width, height, and equals it to rect, we suddenly say like, yeah, we're making away with rect, no more rect. We just want to write x or y, and this enables us to do so. And here we can see that we declare another construct just to show another example. We have a person, constructor, get name, and so on. And here on the top right, we can see that we do the same kind of destructuring syntax with var name age equals person. And we see that, of course, we can write console log name and age, and there is no person involved, right? Because we're lazy, and it's awesome. So if you want to be really lazy, this is a very nice construct to look at. How many heard of destructuring before? Are you all using it? Some of you. Cool. Promises. So promises aren't really TypeScript native, but you know they are there for you as well. But if you want to use it, you have to be using typings or TSD to get the description file for them. But I mean, if you look at promises, you see that we can new up a promise. Let's see where we are. Yeah, very high thing this. We do a return new promise, and inside of the promise constructor, we have a function that we use an arrow function with, and it takes two arguments, resolve and reject. And resolve, of course, is when our data is safely arrived sometime in the future, and reject means something went really bad. So, and of course, returning a promise means that we can take the returning variable here and just do get, then or catch, and then would be mapped to resolve, and catch would be mapped to reject, as we expect, right? So description files, now it becomes interesting. Because when we start out with TypeScript, we have the problem of, we have a lot of legacy code, right? We have a lot of ES5 code. So I mean, we want to start using TypeScript straight away if we like it. But we might have inherited a lot of ES5 code, or we found this really awesome lib on the internet, and it's ES5. What do we do? So description files is really what solves it for us. And this is a way of instructing the TypeScript compiler and saying, yeah, okay, as long as you tell me what these ES5 things are, I'm happy. And this is the job for description files. They are a way to, on a meta level, describe what your ES5 lib look like. So, and definitely type.org is the repository that contains all the known ES5 third-party libraries known to man, basically. There are a lot of them, right? Anyone did the mistake of downloading the whole of definitely typed? I did that. There were plenty. Okay, so how do we do that? Well, we create a file that kind of mimics the JS file, but we call it .d.ts or just .ts. You know, doesn't really matter, as long as it's ts at the end. And we explain to TypeScript on a meta level, what is this, how do I use it, what types do you contain? Okay, let's look at the left first, because here we have ES5 code. The ES5 code is basically a mathematic constructor function with stuff on the prototype, and we put stuff on the class itself. Yeah, you guessed it, it's going to be a class on the right, or, you know, you already peaked, right? So here we can see that we are saying on the meta level, this is a class, it has a static py, and it has a constructor with the new keyword, and it has an add method with these parameters, it returns of type number, and it has a sub method, and so on. How many of you are writing your own description files? I think most of you are using definitely typed, right? Yeah, probably. This might not be something that you want to write yourself. I mean, if there's a third-party library out there that's big, then you need to have a lot of spare time. Here's another example of how to declare your description files. On the left here, you see a do stuff function, and we decide for it here on the right that you are a do stuff function with two parameters of type number, and that you return number, and you know thereby we are very explicit in what do stuff, how it's supposed to behave. And on the two here on the left, we see that we have a more complex function, but this one is more interesting, because we see that we have two parameters, name and config, and config kind of behaves a little weird if you look at it. So we have an if method that says, like, if config is defined and has a length parameter, if it has a game parameter and game equals football, then Messi is great. Well, we know he's great, so. But the point here is that, okay, what do we do with such an ambiguous parameter? I mean, it seems like it can exist, it cannot exist. If it exists, its parameters may or may not exist. So if you look here on the right, on the iconfig, we can see that we have created an interface that matches what it does if it's set, which is basically it has two parameters, game and length, and both of those are optional. And you see here on the right also that our complex function has two parameters with config itself being optional, but of course it will rely on iconfig if it's set to ensure that the contract is followed. And the very last example here is the var singleton, which basically returns an object literal of save and update, and that one is more simple, right? This one looks like an isingleton with methods save and update and a variable singleton. Right, so there are different ways of dealing with TypeScript. This is probably the most painful one, but I thought it might be interesting to see what it looks like on the command line. TSC is what we use to compile TypeScript. And as you see, if we have a very small project consisting of one file, we just specify one file, and when we run it with TSC, we get the corresponding JS ES5 file from it. And the second row is maybe of more interest because our project suddenly has grown 100%, two files. And the third row describes what happens when we try to concatenate all our files into one JS file. This is usually what we want to do, but we set the out flag. If you see line four here, we are using the W, which basically means we watch all the TS files that we specified. If one of those changes, we want to know about it and we want it to be recompiled. And on line five here, we use the keyword modules. And this is where it gets really interesting because suddenly we have a project that, you know, is more close to reality. It consists of hundreds, maybe TS files. and we want to be able to work in a more organized way, you know, separated modules that do one thing well. And at the bottom here, the bottom line, you see that, of course, when we go from the TS world into ES5 world, we wanted to remember what it used to look like, you know, when they used to be TS files. So we set the source map flag to ensure that when we execute it in the browser, we can see, aha, those are the TS files that we recognize from our IDE. Okay, so this is the second version of working with the compiler. Here we kind of declare our own JSON file instead. So we don't want to write a lot of things in the command line, right? So we barely want to create this one, but this one at least makes us a bit more lazy. So here we specify to it what's the compiler options. When we concatenate all the files, what should the resulting file be called? Out.js. What is our target? ES5. We want to remove comments that were written in TS. Yes, we do. And of course, we want source maps, otherwise it's chaotic. And here we see that we need to specify all the files of the project, which can grow to a pretty long list. So this is not an ideal situation either, but it's better than, you know, being writing an essay on the command line. And of course, for bigger projects, you probably use Gulp or Grunt or Webpack or something like that. Now, let's talk about modules. There are basically three modules and just one version of working with modules that I recommend. But I'll, you know, for history's sake, mention the other two that I've kind of left. The first one is the one where we kind of use a reference path plus out file flag when compiling. The second one uses the module flag, which enables us to use AMD or System.js. And the third one is Browserify, and this is the one that you probably are using in your projects. How many use Browserify with TypeScript? None? Okay, cool. One or two. One, I think. Cool. So here you see that the first scenario with the reference path, and here we have an external file called, with the namespace app shapes and the class inside of it being exported, and it's called point. And here you see the starting root app file referencing the other external file so that we can actually tell the IDE what does this one look like. So this is purely for the IDE's thing. And of course, to make the compiler work so it kind of recognizes everything when it concatenates. So to compile all of this, we just need to specify all the other files and specify the out flag. This doesn't really work well. Well, it works, but it's not the way you want to work. That's what I mean. And this is the second version we are using. We are trying to compile with modules. And here you see that there's a bit of a difference here. We have an export class point in an external file. And we see the up file is starting to use import construct, which is a big improvement. But still, we're not really happy with that version. There is no namespace, but we want to use ES6 imports. We are kind of jealous of Angular 2, right? Looks so sweet, TypeScript and ES6 modules. So that's the third version. So here you can see that we have our external file over there on the left. We have the point class. No namespaces anywhere. We see also that we have a rectangle class. And I've actually enlarged the font so much that some code disappeared here at the bottom. But it has an export at the bottom here where it kind of says, I'm trying to export point and rectangle, so anyone importing me here to the right will, you know, be able to use me properly. Here on the right, we have the app file, the starting file, and this one does an import and says, yes, I want to have point, I want rectangle from other. And yeah, this is a very much nicer way to work because now I'm using TypeScript with ES6 modules. And I'm basically in Angular 2. So, and of course, this is dead easy to be using. There's no reason to use anything else. It uses Browserify and TSify in conjunction. So, this one-liner can actually build a very large project for us. And of course, it's only going to crawl the dependencies of all the files that we mention. So this is also a con. So, I mean, if you compare that to other approaches where we scan the entire directory for everything TS, that's a bad approach. So, I mean, this is a better approach because this one is very explicit. I will only use the files that I mention here by import. Where am I with time? I actually have a few slides about something else. Anyone? I have a few minutes? Oh, cool. So I had some other slides, depending on how fast I talk, and that kind of relied on the amount of caffeine in my blood. So now you know, I drank a lot of coffee. Okay, so of course, I've spent the last few months converting a lot of ES5 Angular 1 project into ES6 modules and TypeScript, and it's been a really awesome experience for me, at least. So what does it mean to actually take your project to TypeScript if you're coding Angular? How many have done that? Are you happy with it? One hand. Okay, so there are some pain points. Okay, cool. So what do you actually need to do to turn your ES5 Angular 1 project into TypeScript? Well, you need to rethink a few concepts like controllers, services, models, and of course the bootstrapping is a bit different. But as I already mentioned with the bootstrapping, that's a one-liner, so that one is not really the problem. You can see here, for example, with controllers, on the left here, we have the ES5 version, and we see that we are doing the dollar inject according to some style guide. Yes, Todd, you wrote that one first. All right. Is Todd in the room, by the way? Awesome. Okay, so here you see that we have a controller. It uses a scope. This is pretty old code, right? Most of us are using this instead. And of course, this is the first thing that we do when we go to TypeScript. Away with the scope. No more scope. And one of the things we do is to move the inject function within the class. And of course, we use a constructor, and we use the private accessor for the service. So in this case, it looks a lot nicer. But of course, it may not be that easy to see with just one property. But so basically, the controller turns into a class. That's the bottom line. And services. So with the service, we have an inject of $HTTP, and we can see that our service here on the left uses a revealing module pattern. So we want to convey to the user of our code, what does this class do without reading all 500 lines of it? So here we can see that we have a getData function and so on, and we're using the .factory keyword. So we're going to get away with the .factory and replace that one with the .service, because now, like with the controllers, we're going to start using a class. And we see here that on top, we declare an export interface. This one is optional, but I kind of like it because it kind of conveys what you're trying to do with it, if it's long, as I said. And we declare a class that we also export, and it has a constructor and get data. So these ones are pretty similar. Just a couple of more slides. I don't know if I'm out of time. I'm going to wrap it up. Cool. So this is almost my favorite refactoring when going from ES5 to TypeScript. It kind of removes itself completely from Angular, and that's really what we want, right? More and more of our apps today are very coupled with Angular 1, and we really want them to be separate. So there might come a day when we can actually reuse our business classes, and that would be awesome. So in this case, the model uses a model factory, if you indeed have a model. Some projects don't have a model, but let's pretend you do. We use a model factory, and as we see here, the model factory returns the class model so that we can new it up when we inject it in some service or controller or wherever it may live. But the first thing we do is just remove every dependence on Angular, because we can see that this model only works with its own properties. It has no external dependencies, which allows us to completely remove it from Angular and becomes this very simple vanilla JavaScript. And this is nice. And of course, values and const, there used to be this debate like, okay, which one bootstraps first? Okay, it's the const, and then there's the value. But there's no reason whatsoever to have these inside of Angular at all. They can actually be vanilla JavaScript like so, right? So we write const base URL and we export a number of constants back. And when we use them with the import keyword. And as you see, I mean, half our app just disappears from Angular. When we rewrite the services, when we rewrite the models and consts and values. And that's a good thing. So even though some of you may have pain points with using TypeScript, they're probably related to typings, right? Yeah, some of you nods. I have that pain too. So, but as I said, you're able to clean up your application and it kind of feels safer. And of course, the bootstrapping is my very last slide. So the bootstrapping in this case is one or more Angular files where we actually import all the implementing classes. And in one place, we tell the whole application, like, you have this module, these controllers, these services. So just imagine for a larger project, these are maybe 30 or 40 lines long. And this is just one place where you bootstrap your application. Everything else kind of looks more like normal vanilla JavaScript. Oh, there was one more, but you already saw that line, how to actually bundle everything. So as you see, it's a one-liner, it crawls the dependency. We have to install TSify and Browserify to make that one work. And this, my friends, was everything. Thank you.